Scary time.
History tends to repeat itself constantly, over and over.
There are a lot of legends of witches and buried treasure.
Going on this whole Blair Witch hunt type of thing.
Great opportunity to interview people who had been passing down this legend for a couple of centuries.
And I think it's unfair to the three of them.
And I think they should have paid attention to their surroundings. You can feel her when you're up
there. My older brother, when I was little, used to scare me to the death with the stories of the Blair Witch.
I have no explanation for how this could have happened.
Yes, I believe in ghosts.
Well, supposedly, according to the story, there was 12 witnesses who observed a ghostly white hand come up out of the water and drag the child under the water.
I felt her. I haven't ever seen her, but I felt
her. It made me stand in the corner, turn to the wall, and repeat Blair Witch three times, then hit me with a spotlight, and I break down in tears.
It's difficult to criticize law enforcement when you've been a law enforcement officer before.
He would never leave his family hanging like this.
He had those that said, oh, it's a hoax, and even some of them blame me for being maybe part of the hoax.
I don't believe in ghosts and vampires and communists.
All deep woods are a little bit eerie, and this one is no exception.
It was really strange seeing the footage, very strange.
There's something about watching their last days on video and film that I don't know if I can handle.
I don't know, I can't speak for Heather or Mike, but I know Josh wouldn't do that.
The tapes are a very eerie thing.
I don't even like to think of the Blair Witch. I don't want to talk about it anymore.
The search of the three missing Montgomery College students continues in Frederick County tonight as dozens of volunteers and state officials join local forces in what has now become a full-scale search of the Black Hills area.
Searching. Local officials combined with over 100 search volunteers have failed to come up with any signs of the three missing filmmakers. Montgomery College film students Heather Donahue, Michael Williams, and Joshua Leonard were reportedly shooting a school project about a local myth called the Blair Witch. At this time, their whereabouts are still unknown.
Search of three missing filmmakers has been called off. 10 days and thousands of man hours have been unable to produce any clues to the cause of the mysterious disappearances. Family and friends of the Montgomery College graduates are holding on to the hope that someone or something will provide some answers.
Keep it going.
Yeah.
Mr. Leonard, Keith Whitaker from News Channel 6. May we have a moment of your time? Well, sir, footage has been found related to the disappearance of your son from a year ago. Sir, do you believe the occult may be related to the disappearance of your son?
No, wait a second. No, I don't. And my wife and I are tired of hearing all this crap, all right?
The case of the Black Hills disappearances has once again been closed. The investigation was reopened last October after film reels and video cassettes supposedly belonging to the three missing film students were found by a Maryland University anthropology class. Frederick County police officials declared today that the found footage was inconclusive and that all possible leads on the case have been exhausted. Heather Donahue, Joshua Leonard, and Michael Williams disappeared in 1994 while shooting a documentary film project in the Black Hills area near Burkittsville. The three student filmmakers are still missing.
Well, I've looked at the found footage, and although it jumps around a lot and it's not totally professionally done, I don't see any indication that it's a hoax.
Central reading, how to stay alive in the woods, because you never know what's going to happen.
And I think the legend is unsettling enough.
It was there for approximately a year.
I'm real excited about this. Thank you for the opportunity.
It was not in good condition from what I
saw. Come on.
I have to believe that somebody has done something that has caused these young adults to come up missing. Why would someone do that? I don't really understand.
Okay, that's good.
This is Burkittsville, formerly Blair. It is a small, quiet Maryland town. Much like a small, quiet town anywhere. No more than 20 families laid their roots here over 200 years ago, many of whom remain either on this hill or in the town below. There are an unusually high number of children laid to rest here, most of whom passed in the 1940s. Yet no one in the town seems to recall anything unusual about this time, to us anyway. Yet legend tells a different story. One whose evidence is all around us, etched in stone.
It's been 2 years now, and they're still missing. I think before I went out there, I would take the appropriate precautions. From what I've been informed, and if you look into the history, apparently there have been other search groups in the past, and on some search groups, nobody turned up missing, but on some search groups there was foul play. I understand it goes way back, several centuries back, and decades back, actually.
Now, it's almost impossible to talk about witchcraft in America without talking about the Blair Witch of Maryland in 1786. And the Bell Witch of Adams, Tennessee in 1817. Now, while both of these are interesting academically, it is the Blair Witch that is the most colorful.
The story goes that she had bled a few children, and by that pinpricks, probably because of some sort of illness that she detected or something to that effect.
Burkittsville was actually founded on another old town by the name of Blair. And it was founded here in 1734 to protect the western approaches to Baltimore. But it died out because of a witch that came here. And she appeared here. Her name was Ellie Kedwards. And she took a bunch of the children, kidnapped them, and carried them off into the woods.
The children went back, reported it to their parents. This is, of course, at that time, an early sign of witchcraft. She was tried, summarily convicted, and banished.
There was a book came out about the witch of Blair.
The term Blair Witch was actually coined in 1809 when a book was published.
And I had that book here for a number of years and belonged to the Maryland Historical Society, and they decided they wanted it. It was the only copy there was of it.
I have seen this book. And in the book is filled with bloodletting, all kinds of bloody gore, witchcraft, paganism. Basically, it's a pack of lies. Don't believe any of it.
It's a pretty true, pretty factual book about what really happened here. But the Maryland Historical Society wanted it back, and they took it over, almost over my dead body.
And so that began, really, the term Blair Witch.
The awful hag wrenched the boy's head from his writhing body and defiled the church with his warm blood. It was then that I noticed a dog's teat had sprouted from her leg. She controlled the animals of the forest, even the trees seeming to do her bidding. When she walked, she didn't touch the ground, and her followers made a horrible mulch of the countless dead littering the streets.
The Blair Witch Cult by Anonymous, 1809.
And then in 1824, a rich planter founded the town of Burkittsville on the old site of the Blair community.
And my grandfather related a story to me. After the wheat came in that year and everybody was through with all their farming and stuff,
decided to go on a picnic, a bunch of them did, down on this little creek. The creek was real shallow. It was only probably 6 to 8 inches deep. A child could just wade across or crawl across there, really. It was so shallow.
This little girl was playing in a very shallow stream of water, and she drowned.
And they heard her hollering and struggling and looked out there, and this white hand had come up out of the water. That's all they could see. Nobody ever saw a face or body. All they remember seeing was the arm and the hand.
But I have a problem with this story. How is it that 11 people happened to be in the right place at the same time to simultaneously see this ghostly hand come up and drag this child under the water? I think that in the case of the Eileen Trakel story, is that there's another explanation, that perhaps it was something like parental neglect.
The river, according to what we've been told through written records, then turns oily and has a bunch of stick figures floating into it for the next week. No one can use the river for any kind of water for food or drinking or anything like that. It's totally unusable.
There was a man downstream a little later that drank some of that water and it killed him.
Well, we go about 60 years forward in time, we come up to 1886, and there was a very gruesome event that occurred. A child by the name of Robin Weaver, an 8-year-old girl, she disappears into the forest.
Well, in 1885, there was a lady lived there in town when I was a boy. She was 50 years old when I knew her, and she told me that when she was a little girl, she would had been walking in the woods one day, and this lady appeared to her. And she wasn't walking, she was floating in the air, really.
But it's plausible here that this little girl was only telling a story of the Blair Witch as she heard it from maybe her parents, her siblings, or her friends.
But in the meantime, the town had started a search for her. They sent out a search party to look for her in the woods.
The first search party that had gone out to look for the little girl had vanished. So they formed a second search party to go look for the first search party. And what they found was a massacre.
And when they got to a place called Coffin Rock out there, the men were laying on that rock, all dead. But they were almost tied together like they were a raft.
The first search party had been killed, laid out on a flat rock in the woods. They had been disemboweled.
You could tell they were alive when they were tied up because the ropes had cut into them and the ropes were bloody from cutting into their wrists and legs.
And on their faces, their hands and feet were carved these strange pagan symbols.
Rather than look really what it was, they took off back to town, which I'd probably done too, because gosh, you find all these dead men there, you wonder who's waiting there to kill you.
So the search party goes back to get help, and when they return, the bodies have vanished without a trace.
They could smell the death in the air. Where people have died, it always leaves an odor in the air. And they could smell that, but actually they never found anything. And by the way, the lady said she never again went in those woods as long as she, up till I knew her when she was 50 years old, she'd never went in the woods again.
But it seems that 60 years from the Robin Weaver case, we come up to 1940.
Sort of in the winter, I guess, the fall or the winter 1940, some of the young kids started to disappear, and nobody knew anything about why they were disappearing.
And I was a boy myself at that time, but I was a little bit bigger than these kids that disappeared, even though my mother would let me out of her sight.
I will remember to my dying day that look on my mother's face when she was told that my brother was murdered.
And one by one, up until seven of them had disappeared.
Finally, one day, old Mr. Parr come down into the market and said, "I'm finally finished."
And what did he mean by that?
Well, I guess nobody knew at first, but the police finally went up on the mountain, and they searched his house, and they found the bodies of seven kids from the area.
And he's brought to trial for this, and he admits to the crime. But he says that he did it for an old lady ghost.
And I had a tape one time of a television of a newsreel showing him as he was murdered. He was killed for murdering those seven boys.
Now it's possible that this man was trying to fit himself into the mythos of the Blair Witch. But that's conjecture.
Why did you do it, Mr. Farr?
I heard voices in my head.
What kind of voices?
A woman's.
Whose voice, Mr. Farr?
No idea who it was.
Well, the same, Mr. Farr.
I grew up and got out of there, and I didn't want to go back to that place. It was, that little town was just too full of horrible memories.
It does seem that it's almost 60-year intervals between these events, and I do find that very strange. It is very strange. Whether or not it's a coincidence, or whether or not there's some other explanation for it, who knows?
Supposed to haunt.
Uh-huh.
And they disappeared off the face of the earth.
No. Really?
Okay, it's all right, Ingrid. I'm just telling a scary story, but it's not true.
The mother of Michael Williams contacted my office to report that her son and two others had gone off into the woods. They were film students, and she hasn't heard from them in about 4 days and wanted to file a missing persons report. I personally went up and in the woods searching the area. I located a vehicle that belonged to the students on Black Rock Road, had it impounded and did some more searching. Still couldn't locate a campsite, and I called in to Frederick County investigators for assistance.
I received a call from Mrs. Angela Donahue, and she was somewhat desperate to find an investigator that would look into the mysterious disappearance of her daughter, Heather, and two other individuals, Josh and Michael, who were in some deep woods in Maryland at the time that they turned up missing.
Well, Heather was probably one of the two or three best students that I've had the pleasure of teaching. She was committed, she was energetic, she was very creative. She was someone who I think reminded me of myself really a lot at her age. Joshua was more glitz. He thought it would be cool to be in the film business.
The last thing I remember saying to him was the night before he left. He had a vision, he had a hope of becoming something, you know, that he felt was important. And I said, look, if you're going to be happy, go for it. By all means, go for it. That's what you should strive for, just to be happy.
The tapes were found. The anthropology class was out there doing a dig, and they had found these tapes.
All of a sudden, there was this sound like a bunch of rocks falling or something, and I heard a lot of people kind of calling out, and went over to the site. And about 20 minutes later, Pete comes running up, and he's got this dirty old like a backpack in his hand. And he tells me that when they were clearing out the debris from where the wall caved in, is he had noticed in the bottom, it would be sort of the interior bottom basement of where the house was, he saw a little like a black belt, he thought, sticking out of the ground. And he kind of dug around there and pulled it out, and what it was a backpack.
Sometime later, when the footage was found, the police brought that footage to me and asked me to look at it. All I could really tell them was, yes, that was Heather, and that was Joshua.
Footage was found, allegedly, that was filmed by the three students. I contacted a local color lab. We got it developed, and I reviewed the film.
I checked with some of my colleagues in archaeology, sort of, you know, quietly, if they had ever heard of anything like this. None of them had.
It makes you wonder if Heather and Josh and Michael or either one of them had hidden that tape there, or if someone else had.
This backpack was found in a sterile soil, which is like the bottom of a site. Just, you know, from there to the middle of the earth is just dirt. The original house at the site had burned down, and so there was a layer of ash that was like sitting in the interior of the house, like the basement. So this knapsack had been in sterile soil with no evidence around it of disturbance. Over the top of it was an undisturbed layer of ash, and the whole thing was boxed in by basically a colonial era wall that was undisturbed. It was, even a forensic expert could not have put that thing into the site without disturbing the charcoal, the wall, or sterile soil. It was as if it materialized. And of course, that's not the language of science, so I just don't know what to say about this, really.
And all I found was the students themselves, some scary noises in the woods at night, and a few examples of that, but no concrete evidence on what happened to the students.
The tapes show footage of the three individuals that I had mentioned, Heather and Josh and Michael, in situations of fear and being distraught and, of course, screaming for help and so forth. And there's obviously some external factors there that are causing them to be upset, even though you don't see it on the tape.
I heard indirectly that apparently on these, what was on these films were something to do with the disappearance of these three film students who'd gone up into the mountains to do their project and had never been heard from again.
No idea what happened to them. To me, it looks like it's a hoax, but it's a little strange that they've never made an appearance in 5 years.
I have a feeling that they were killed. They were murdered. And we should throw this Blair Witch theory out the window.
I don't think that's the kind of thing that Heather would have been involved in. It's been several years now. I'd also like to believe that if this was some kind of practical joke, that sometime in the interim, I would have perhaps been let in on the joke.
Be remote that it's a hoax because of the way the tapes were hidden and the fact that it, just to view the tapes, they are very realistic, and they do, the tape is from a time period that the students would have been able to have taped it.
Searcher interview. Can you clap, buddy, right in front of your face? Okay.
Okay, buddy, go ahead, state your name.
Hi, my name is Bud Michaels. Spell it B-U-D-M-I-C-H-E-L-S.
I'm Mark Mason, spelling it M-A-R-K-M-A-S-O-N.
You guys work for the fire department off and on, pretty much?
We have a rotation every couple days. Got to sit in. Do duty there.
So, Bud, how'd you guys hear about the filmmakers?
Well, part of the volunteer fire department in Burkittsville, and just seen it on TV, and got asked to, you know, see if we want to help out and volunteer for this, help search, find these folks that are lost up there.
Now, where was the search conducted, pretty much?
Back along those woods there, that whole area actually down.
Whole hill.
Down to the interstate down there.
Did you find any clues or anything like that?
No. Never saw anything, some soda cans, that was about it.
Crushed beer cans, things like that, stuff to make us thirsty. But nothing really that told us where they were or what happened or anything. Nothing related directly to them that we could tell.
How many times did you guys search the area?
Must have crossed through it 5 or 6 times over the days, the week that we were searching.
Yeah, back and forth all the time.
We went everywhere, about 100 of us.
Upon viewing the tapes at the firehouse, is there anything else that seemed a little suspicious to you?
Yeah, it's kind of weird, the discrepancy between the number of days that they were supposedly out there and when we started searching for them. It looked like they out there like 4 or 5 days or whatever. It was just kind of strange.
That's strange, we never ran into them.
Yeah.
So you're saying that the time they spent out there should have overlapped the time you guys were searching?
Yeah
unless that was shot somewhere on like the moon or something, because we had helicopters and search planes.
We got out there on Tuesday, and some of those tapes, they were talking about it being Friday already.
Really?
And, seemed kind of strange that we could have that many guys out there and didn't see them, didn't run into them, they didn't hear anything. You know, if somebody wants to be found, it's strange.
You guys seen this tape at all?
We kind of seen a couple hours of it through some connections we had at the fire department, because they kept the film in there because it's kind of cool in the fire department there. So we were able to go down there and look some of the footage. kind of. I don't want to get anybody in trouble, but.
So you guys saw the tapes at the firehouse. You saw, like you were saying, a few hours or so. Is there any other strange things that you can think of?
There's all these stick guys up in the woods on the tapes that.
Like scarecrow type guys.
Yeah. Like scarecrow, like.
Where do you think they were?
30 of them. I don't know. It might have been some kind of cult thing.
Have you been up there recently or at all after that to see?
No. I haven't been there in years.
Yeah, I used to go fishing with my buddies up there, but we don't really go up there no more. Just until we figure out what happened. It's kind of like the Loch Ness Monster, you know, you just don't want to go out there in the water until they find out really what the problem or the cause was.
Okay, that's a good cut. There's just so much I want to do with my life. I want to do things. I haven't done anything. This is anything. I haven't done anything. And I don't understand why it's happening to us. How many people will go on camping trips?
We weren't just going on a camping trip, and that's why I feel like it's all my fault.
It's not your fault anymore. It's nobody's fault. You can't have a fault for something this enormous. A human cannot be faulted for something this enormous. It's impossible. It's not your fault. I don't want you to think that. Okay? Heather?
Okay.
Look at me.
Good luck to me explaining that to Josh's mom. Good luck.
It's not your fault. We have everything documented. It's not your fault. Hey. Hey! Heather. Come here. It's not your fault, okay? It's not your fault.
I know, it's not my fault. It's not my fault. It's fine.
There's nothing we know about. There's nothing.
I just want to know how to get out of here. I don't care about the movie anymore now. I'm just taping so in case somebody finds it, they can find out what happened to us.
They will find out. Only God knows. God should take care of us. God will take care of us. God will take care of us. I know it.
I don't believe in God.
I know He will. I know.
I don't believe in God. What am I supposed to do? I believe in fairies and witches and...
You gotta believe in God if you believe in all that crap. Oh, your hands are cold.
I know. I'm scared, Mike.
I'm scared. I'm scared too.
I'm scared
too.
I'm scared.
It's okay.
I'm scared.
It's okay. We're gonna shoot some 16 tonight.
Right.
And we're gonna let everybody know what the deal is with this shit. Somebody eventually will figure it out and take care of it.
I don't wanna kill them.
We gotta calm down.
Okay.
We don't know anything yet. We just gotta calm down.
Okay, calm down. We're gonna calm down. We're in a different place tonight. And maybe we'll be fine, okay?
We gotta calm down.
Okay. 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 Alright. Let's get the other camera out. Let's lay out the bags. Let's just get our shit together, okay?
Alright.
Put a tarp over the gear. You get the dad out. And we'll just fucking record, and whatever happens, we will have it all. And so if anything happens to us, people will know exactly what it was.
Okay. We gotta stop this. We're not done yet.
No, we're not. We are all in one piece. We are fine. We are fine. Might be only two of us, but we're fine.